Good morning and thanks for joining us. I'm Zoya Raines Freeman, the chair of this morning's Congressional Breakfast. On behalf of the Jewish Community Relations Council of New York and our host, the UJA Federation of New York, it's my pleasure to welcome you to our 2017 Congressional Breakfast. We're also grateful to our corporate benefactor, Capital One, whom you'll hear from in a moment. Your presence this morning attests to your deep and abiding concern for the welfare of the United States of America, New York, Israel, and the Jewish people worldwide. Look around the room. We are the Jewish community where you know there is remarkable diversity and you know there is also incredible unity. We New Yorkers are blessed with an exceptionally informed and dynamic congressional delegation. Even though many are in the minority, they consistently provide crucial national leadership on Capitol Hill on issues of concern to all New Yorkers and on issues important to the Jewish community. This morning, we're going to be able to ask them some questions about the key issues and to learn about their positions on vital matters prominent on the communal agenda. Before we begin the program, we'd like to ask each of our guests to honor JCRC's commitment to relationship building and respect all of our speakers. Please help us provide a welcoming environment. And with that, please welcome our leader, JCRC President Charles Temmel.
Good morning, and thank you for being here, especially on a rainy Sunday morning. Now, as some of you may have noticed, my wife said you need a copy of the speech. And I just thought I would, in case you saw that little exchange, I'd explain to you why we do that. At my younger brother's bar mitzvah, he lost his speech and he was sitting up on the bima and he was signaling that he couldn't find his speech. And I went looking all over, couldn't find one, actually started writing him another one, found the copy, gave it to him. And from then on in our family, there's always a tradition, two speeches, whoever's giving the speech gets one and another member of the family gets the other, just in case that happens again. So towards the end of services yesterday morning, we said two prayers that when I thought about it, I realized would help me explain the context of this event this morning. We say two prayers at the end of services. We say a prayer for our country, and we say a prayer for the state of Israel. On your tables this morning, there's a copy on the 2017 edition, Community Concerns. Basically, if you look at this, if you look at the table of contents, you can break it down into three parts. Our concerns for our community, the less fortunate here in New York, our concern for the safety and security of the state of Israel, and our concern for Jews around the world. In the prayer for our country, one of the things we ask is that our leaders act with wisdom and understanding to root out poverty from our land. That's what drives the concerns of our parent agency, UJA Federation. We're celebrating 100 years of services to the Jewish community of New York, around the world, and also services to our community of New York as well. The prayer also goes on to ask that we be awakened to uproot from our hearts hatred and malice and work to bring peace and friendship among the many peoples and faiths who dwell in our nation. And those are the concerns of the JCRC that drive our programs on interfaith and intergroup understanding and friendship. The JCRC also plays an important part in trying to root out anti-Semitism, BDS, and enhancing the security of our institutions. We're also concerned for the safety and the security of the state of Israel and the people of Israel. And those are our core values as Americans, as New Yorkers, and as Jews. So this morning, we thank the members of the congressional delegation of New York and all the public servants who are here for joining us. We've had long-standing ties to all of you, and we appreciate your commitment and your sensitivity to the concerns of the Jewish community. This morning, we're also trying out a new format. The questions that will be asked have already been given to the speakers. We've asked them specific questions to address our concerns, and they very graciously have accepted that format. We'll see how it works this year. So I also like to thank right at the outset the JCRC team led by Marcy Fishman for putting on a tremendous congressional breakfast. And I'd also like to thank our corporate sponsor, Capital One. During this morning's dialogue, I ask that all of you give our guests the deference and the respect that they deserve. They've been very gracious with their time, and we want them to walk away from here appreciating the graciousness of our audience. And lastly, but very important, there's a piece of information on your tables announcing the 2017 gala on March 29th. We're going to be honoring the Catsimatidis family. We're honoring the great Tom DiNapoli, Comptroller of the State of New York. And we're honoring U.S. Bank Corp, one of the best banks in the United States, and one that's been a tremendous partner to the communities that they serve. So, I hope you can join us on the 29th. However, our work would not be accomplished without our parent agency, UJA Federation. UJA is celebrating, as I said, 100 years of service to the Jewish community. UJA works in New York, works in Israel, works around the world. And it's my honor and privilege to introduce Eric Goldstein and Louisa Chafee, Senior Vice President for Public Policy at UJA Federation.
Thank you very much, Charles, and good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome all of you to UJA Federation and to the Jewish Community Relations Council 2017 Congressional Breakfast. We're proud to be, very proud to be, the largest financial supporter of the Jewish Community Relations Council. As we all know, they serve an incredibly vital function in New York, led by the incredibly effective Michael Miller and President Charles Temel. They provide a critical table, a table for the Jewish community, the non-Jewish community, to come together to address our community's greatest challenges. We all know that what unites us far greater than what divides us, but it's the JCRC table that allows us to come together so effectively, and it's particularly important that we do so in these times. As Charles mentioned, UJA Federation is celebrating its centennial. For 100 years, we've been protecting the Jewish people, securing the Jewish future, promoting Jewish and communal unity, and taking care of people, caring for people in need, whatever their background. It's our pleasure, and we look forward to continuing our relationship with JCRC for many, many years to come, and we thank you all for attending this important breakfast. It's now my privilege to have Louisa Chafee, our Senior Vice President for Public Policy and External Relations, to say a few words. Louisa.
Thank you, Eric, and thank you, Michael, and JCRC. It's a pleasure to be here this morning on this seasonally appropriate February morning. So as Eric said, UJA turns 100, and we have 100 years of working with nonprofits, and we look forward to the future of working with nonprofits. And today, we really want to think about some of the clients we serve: the poor, the near poor, people with disabilities, seniors, and recent immigrants are just a few of the critical clients that UJA has worked with. We're proud to work hand in hand with other ethnic, religious, and other umbrella organizations such as Catholic Charities, Federation for Protestant Welfare Agencies, United Neighborhood Houses, the Human Services Council, because together we help New Yorkers and their nonprofits stay stronger. We're working together in this time of federal transition to specifically create a roundtable to think about how the changing federal policies impact our city, our nonprofits, our clients, and our communities. And we look forward to frequent dialogue about this. We want to thank our elected officials who are here for the leadership they've given in areas, but also really stress the focus of areas to come. We at UJA are particularly focused, for example, on Holocaust survivors and thinking about how to continue federal government assistance to elderly, vulnerable seniors, Holocaust survivors, and recognizing that they cannot be abandoned in this time. That's one example of a program. Other programs that are critical to UJA and its agencies are SNAP, food benefits, and thinking about the myriad New Yorkers who use this, and frankly, the economic development of SNAP. We also want to recognize how many seniors and children are dependent on this program. And lastly, I really want to stress the incredible importance of keeping the ACA, Medicaid and Medicare, stable. We cannot speak quietly about this issue, and we ask you to take our voices back to Washington. The potential for change to our community is dramatic, and we really focus and work with you and look forward to future working. So in closing, I want to thank you for coming and working with us, and we look forward to helping and working with you, and thank you for taking our messages back.
Please join me in welcoming our good friend, Amir Usagi, Deputy Consul General of Israel and New York. He coordinates the political work of Israel's largest mission in the world and acts as liaison for the foreign ministry to the national and local leadership of the Jewish community. If that's not enough, he also coordinates interfaith dialogue and outreach nationally for the foreign ministry and its missions in the U.S., bringing greetings from the government of Israel to Honorable Amir Usagi.
Good morning. Thank you, Zoya, and I'd just like to apologize for my voice. I've been under the weather a little bit. It's been Tu B'Shvat yesterday in Israel, you know. Somehow the spring has not come yet to New York, but we're looking forward for it. Very soon we'll see the flowers blooming too. So Tu B'Shvat Sameach to all of you. Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to join you today. I want to begin by acknowledging the incredible work Rabbi Michael Miller and the entire JCRC team are doing. They're doing it day, in and out, to support the U.S.-Israel relations and being one of the most respected leaders in our Jewish community. We're thankful for you, Michael, and for all your team. Also, allow me to thank the President, Charlie Temel, for his leadership, Marcy and Zoya for your work on this congressional breakfast, especially the commitment to deepening the relations with the Latino community, Johnny, through your background. I'll relate to that shortly later. Last but certainly not least, I would like to recognize and thank the many members of the Congress and elected officials and my colleague diplomats here in the room that I joined this morning, especially those who have visited our consulate lately and got to know our new Consul General, Ambassador Danny Dayan, who unfortunately is traveling today, but he sends his very, very best regards to all of you. On behalf of the State of Israel, I want to commend those members of the New York delegation who have defended Israel many times on the floor of the Congress. We've seen how you've passed legislation that not only protects Israel from existential threats around it, but from the relentless campaign in international forums like the United Nations, who seek to unfairly single out and vilify Israel with such a regularity that it's become a standard operating process. Specifically, Israel was extremely thankful for the recent bill you all contributed to support to condemn the UN Security Council Resolution 2334. That resolution reminds us of when the former Israeli statesman, Abba Ibn, famously said, if Algeria introduced a resolution declaring that the earth was flat and Israel is to be blamed for it, it would pass by a vote of 164, 13 would be against it, and 23 would abstain. Abba Ibn's remark also reminds us of the early time in the U.S.-Israel relations when the unshakable alliance between our countries was solidified into the partnership we have today. Yet we realize that the time has gone on. This alliance was forged during the leadership of Lyndon Johnson and Nixon and Golda Meir and Levi Eshkol in Israel. While the foundation of the Israel-U.S. alliance remained unchanged, we must acknowledge that from time to time, just like a car needs an oil change, this relationship is also due for some tune-up. Israel, like many of you, sees the changing American society and the rise of diverse communities. The demographics speak for themselves. Israel, too, is an inclusive country, and our message is that we want to embrace all across sections of the American public and make ourselves relevant to them. This includes our friends from the Latino, African American, Asian, LGBT, and other community groups. For us, a strong U.S. alliance means ensuring that all Americans feel embraced, welcomed, and connected to the modern Jewish state in ways that are meaningful to their lives. However, we turn to the political climate in the U.S. I want to reiterate that the most important Israeli position of all is that our relationship with America remains bipartisan at all costs. The greatest challenge Israel may face in the coming in becoming a divisive partisan issue, we need your help to make sure that that doesn't happen. While we look forward to working with the new Trump administration and the Republican Party and thank them for their strong, consistent support of Israel, we also remain committed to maintaining our friendship and cooperation and support for the Democrats and liberals across the country. Israel has a duty to work with any U.S. administration and all elected officials and to stay out of domestic American politics. That being said, we are excited and honored that Prime Minister Netanyahu will be meeting the new President Trump the day after tomorrow, making him among the first world leaders to visit the White House. This visit will most likely highlight several areas that are of serious concern to Israel, and I mentioned just few. Firstly, we continue to be extremely worried about the ongoing threat posed by Iran, including their long-term desire to acquire nuclear weapons, their support of global terrorism, and their ongoing missile program, which threatens Israel, the U.S., and the entire free world. We saw Iran brazenly test several missiles just last week, and we were glad to see that the White House condemned this act and sent a clear message to Tehran. Despite that warning, Iran still conducted some other missile tests. Iran's missile program is being developed in tandem with their nuclear ambitions as a vehicle to threaten Israel, America, and the West. We hope that the U.S. will act to halt this threat. Israel believes it a mistake not to equate these two programs and sees the terrible reality of North Korea as a product when these programs are allowed to continue unchecked. As mentioned, Iran remains the top sponsor of terrorism in the world. Israel has confirmed Iranian troops and Iranian-trained Shia militias fighting in Syria who are responsible for grotesque human rights abuses and massacres against civilians. We have noted how Iran is supporting Hezbollah in Lebanon, the Assad regime in Syria, and has destabilized Yemen. Iran's brutal interference in the Middle East should be a case for concern for all of us. All those who are now looking at the aftermath of the Syrian civil war and how it will be addressed. I would like to note that as a result of that war, Israel has continued to operate a field hospital to treat wounded Syrian civilians. And recently, Israel has approved bringing over 100 orphan Syrian children who will be rehabilitated and given residence in Israel. During tomorrow's meeting with President Trump, we also expect the Prime Minister to discuss Israel's interest in peace with the Palestinians and the ways to advance that process through areas of mutual understanding. Along those lines, we not only hope to speak about the various challenges and obstacles in the Middle East, but also how we can capitalize on new opportunities and emerging alliances, which Israel believes can bring more stability to the region. Additionally, Israel remains deeply disturbed about the upsurge of anti-Semitism around the world, and we are also severely troubled by anti-Semitic hate crimes taking place in the New York area and around the U.S. These include recent threats on Jewish community centers, along with hate speech and vandalism. We support American efforts to respond quickly to these serious issues and thank New York political leadership for speaking out. We appreciate the NYPD and all the law enforcement agencies for taking all necessary measures to investigate them and mitigate these threats. Going forward, the Israeli consulate in New York looks forward to partnering in various congressional districts in New York, and we hope to be a source of innovation and economic benefit. Recently, Israel's economy is continuing to be very strong, and proud to share with you that we have been ranked 10th in the 2016 Bloomberg Innovation Index and second in the Innovation Index by the World Economic Forum. In the area of cybersecurity alone, Israel attracted Last year, 1/4 of all global investment in cybersecurity research and development. These are outstanding achievements for a small country. We look forward to sharing this success in New York with almost 400 Israeli startup companies located in the city alone. My friends, I want to conclude by saying that while the situation around Israel may look unwelcoming, we are ready to contribute broadly to both the American economy and mutual issues of quality of life. We also take seriously all concerns of the Jewish community in America and want to be everything to do everything we can to make sure Israel does not become a wedge issue between Jews in New York and Israel. I look forward to working with all of you to achieve the goal, that goal, and to keep the alliance between Israel and America even stronger and make the world a better place. Thank you all and God bless.
Amir, thank you. Thank you for your words. We look forward to the Prime Minister's visit. And more important, frankly, as your friend, I hope you feel better soon. This is whatever it is. I was thinking of starting a foundation to cure the disease that affects most New Yorkers. It's an interesting disease. It's called this foundation to cure what's going around. I don't know. What do you have? I don't know. It's going around. We're deeply grateful to our corporate benefactor this morning, Capital One. They're an exceptional corporate citizen. They support many, many worthy causes, and we appreciate them for underwriting this event this morning, and we thank our board members, Stuart Kahn and Jeff Weisenfeld, for their assistance. Here to represent Capital One is Steve Tulip. He's the head of Capital Markets. In his role, he's responsible for developing and implementing new product solutions and capabilities to deepen client relationships. I think to deepen client relationships, you don't need as many words, but he's really, really good at it because he's also done this at JP Morgan and Goldman Sachs before getting to Capital One. So we'd like to ask you to say a few words, and I'd like everyone to give a warm welcome to Steve this morning.
I'm going to say a few words because understanding the audience is half of the battle in most of these cases. But we're really thrilled to be able to sponsor such a worthwhile event. Like at Capital One, we believe that our business is only as successful as our communities are, and it's important that they remain healthy and striving. Last year, we gave over $46 million to nonprofit organizations that help provide economic opportunities in communities where our associates live and work. But it's not just dollars we provide. Our associates are incredibly generous with their talent and time. And last year, Capital One associates spent over 365,000 hours in our communities and with charitable programs. Now, we had just heard the importance of digital technology going forward in our environment and how we're going to be responsible as a society going forward. And with technology changing at such a rapid pace, there are a lot of folks who don't have the skills and capabilities to succeed in what will be a digital world, whether it's lack of education or financial resources. And Capital One is dedicated to providing opportunities that will enable more people to succeed in an ever-changing digital economy. We're committing $150 million in community grants and initiatives over the next 5 years aimed at helping people develop their job skills for today and tomorrow. Our mission at Capital One is to change banking for good, and we're seeking to help people get better control of their personal finances in order to make the best decisions for their future. Thanks for allowing us to sponsor this really worthwhile event and program. We couldn't be more thrilled to be here. Thank you.
Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
For one or two who might not know who I am, I'm Michael Miller. I'm the CEO of the JCRC, and it's a pleasure to be standing here today and looking out at this well-filled room of so many friends and people in positions of influence, internal to the Jewish community and external to the world at large. I thought it would be important before we start with the congressional presentations, introductions and presentations, that our congresspeople, as well as all of us, should know some of the folks who are in the room together with us. So I'm going to first start with some of the diplomats who are here. I apologize in advance for the mispronunciation of your names, but you know who you are, and if I mispronounce your names, nobody's going to know the difference other than yourself. So I'm going to do it alphabetically by country. So starting with Belarus, the first secretary of the permanent mission of Belarus to the United Nations, Alexei Kolesov. You can applaud. The Consul General of the People's Republic of China in New York, Ambassador Zhang Qiyu. The Consul General of the Republic of Cyprus in New York, Ambassador Vasilio Filippo. The Consul General of Germany in New York, Ambassador Britta Wagner. Consul General of the Republic of Kosovo in New York, Ambassador Tuta Sahat Tuga. And the ambassador is accompanied by the first secretary of the consulate, who we had the pleasure of meeting in our office, Ines Demiri, who's also a member of the Jewish community. We have the Consul General of the Republic of Lithuania in New York, Ambassador Julius Pranavisius. Consul General of Poland in New York, recently appointed Ambassador Maciej Golubiewski. Or something like that. the Consul General of Portugal in New York, Ambassador Manuela Barros. And out of order in terms of the alphabetical, but from the government of Israel, the political advisor to the Deputy Consul General, Andrew Gross. Andrew? Okay. In terms of elected officials on state side, we'll start with the acting district attorney of Kings County, the Honorable Eric Gonzalez. From the New York State Assembly, we have Charles Levine and David Weprin. And before we get to the City Council, we have just been joined by the New York City Comptroller, Scott Stringer. New York City Council Member, Helen Rosenthal. The Chair of the Jewish Caucus, Mark Levine, New York City Council Member. New York City Council Member Karen Kozowitz. Karen. And wonderful former New York State Senator, Honorable Manfred Orenstein. Fred? Okay. We also have many friends from the non-Jewish community who joined us this morning. And let me start with our dear friend Ravi Batra, the Chairman of the National Advisory Council of South Asian Affairs. Ravi? Wonderful friends all, the first vice president of 100 Black Men and associate pastor of the Canaan Baptist Church, Reverend Jacques DeGraff. Accompanying the Consul General of China is Fred Tang, the president of the America-China Public Affairs Institute and the founder of the Chinese Community Relations Council, CCRC. We came first. the president and founder of the Chinese Cultural Foundation, Elizabeth Wang. From the Korean community, one of the leaders, Min-Sung Kim. Min-Sung. The chairman of the board of APAC, Robert Cohn. Bob. Chancellor Emeritus of the City University of New York, Matthew Goldstein. The Chair of Public Policy Committee of UJA Federation, Karen Kasner. And the Executive Director of the Catholic Community Relations Council, yes, another CCRC, Joseph Rosenberg. Joe? We have been joined as well by many of the board members of the JCRC. I'm not going to go through all the names. I just want to acknowledge the past president of JCRC, Janice Shorenstein. I can just ask all the board members of the JCRC who are here to please stand. We can give you a round of applause. and the Consul General of Mexico, Deputy Consul General of Mexico, is in the room as well. Please give her a welcome. We'll have other acknowledgments as we go along. I'm going to turn the program over to Donna Jakubowicz.
Good morning. Please join me in welcoming the Honorary Carolyn Maloney, representing the New York's 12th District, Manhattan's East Side and Western Queens. Congressman Maloney, you have been one of the foremost leaders on Capitol Hill in ensuring Holocaust remembrance. What additional measures should be taken by Congress so that we never forget the Shoah and to support the dwindling number of Holocaust survivors in America?
Thank you. First and foremost, we are really living in very difficult and dangerous and troubling times, and we are going to have to stick together. We have to remember that Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East, and we have to make sure she is protected and that her people are protected. I want to thank Donna for her question, and also Charles Temmel for his leadership, and Michael Miller, and also Zoya Rains Friedman for putting this all together, and the UJ Federation and Eric Goldstein for hosting us so beautifully today. I first put legislation in years ago, and two friends who happen to be here and members of this organization expressed to me their concern in the growing number of Holocaust deniers and really anti-Semitic actions, and it is Stuart and Janice Shorenstein. And thank you for being here today and for your friendship and for inspiring me. And I put in legislation, it's the type of bill that if you've got it to the floor, it would definitely pass, but getting it to the floor has been very difficult. More than 70 years have passed since the liberation of Auschwitz, and as time passes, people forget. As George Santayana said, if you do not remember the past, you are destined to repeat it. So the Holocaust was a uniquely horrifying event where one country, Germany, used all of its science and mechanical know-how to try to eradicate an entire population. You cannot talk about it without remembering that 6 million Jews were murdered, or that the Nazis intended to kill all Jews. That's why it was very troubling where literally recently the White House blocked a Holocaust Remembrance Day release mentioning Jews. And when I called the State Department and said, how did this happen? They said that their draft included Jews, but that it was removed in the White House. And then I asked, why was it removed? They said, we want to be inclusive. Well, we're an inclusive country, but you have to be factually accurate. And I think it points out why my legislation is needed. And when I go back this next week, I hope to reintroduce my Simon Wiesenthal Holocaust Education Assistance Act, which amends the Elementary and Secondary Education Act. It specifies that the Holocaust was a historical event that resulted in the systemic, state-sponsored mass murders by Nazi Germany of 6 million Jews, along with millions of others, in the name of racial purity. Six states, including New York State, currently mandate the Holocaust be taught in the schools, and 11 more suggest that it should be taught, but they provide no funds to assist. This bill would give federal weight to Holocaust education and would provide grants to help design appropriate curriculum and teaching materials. We would have these materials in the National Board of Education, so that teachers across the country could access it and use it in their classroom, not having to repeat and come up with their own lesson plans on fighting anti-Semitism, on being inclusive, and really fighting any attempt to minimize or forget the Holocaust. We are already seeing efforts to
minimize the Holocaust, to introduce the incredibly twisted suggestion that Jews were somehow complicit in their own genocide or their destruction of their own families in order to put pressure on the world to create Israel, and efforts to generalize it so that we forget that Jews were the specific target of the Nazis' murderous hate. It was the final solution. It was targeted, and we have to remember that. I had a unique experience recently. I went to the 69th Remembrance of Auschwitz with Eric Cantor. At the time, he was the majority leader in the House, and he was representing his party. I was representing mine at this very important remembrance. And although I had my bill in, I had read books, and I had studied the Holocaust in Auschwitz, there is nothing like seeing it. It is transformational. You cannot believe the horror. We must always keep that museum alive, because in your mind you could never think that anyone could be so cruel or so precise or use science in such a destructive and horrible way. I literally almost passed out. I couldn't believe how unbelievably cruel it was. And as disturbing as it is to see it, I think it's important for everyone to see it, to see the importance of remembering the Holocaust and making sure that it never happens again. I also had the honor of representing our country at the opening of a museum that the Polish government sponsored and built on the site of the Warsaw Uprising, which really told the glorious contribution of the Jewish community to Poland and all of the positive aspects of it. But believe me, it is important to maintain and keep Auschwitz alive. And I know that many, I must tell you, when I was in Poland, I went around and there were all these synagogues that they were really more beautiful than any synagogues that we have here in America that I've ever seen. Gorgeous synagogues, but they didn't have people going to these synagogues. But what was interesting is that most of them were rebuilt by this organization, other organizations, and Jewish leaders here in America. And I was very proud and of the contribution of the American Jewish community in keeping this alive. And I was told this one story that they brought together all these kids in Poland to tell them that they were Jewish. And they didn't know, they had been hidden. And so they were brought back to, in this ceremony, so they told them that they were Jewish. There was utter silence in the room. And people didn't know what to do. And then someone started singing a hymn that you sang to children called Raisins and Honey. And the whole room started singing Raisin and Honey. The memory came back to the people. And they have their own JCRC's and activities, and we visited them with activities like we're having today. I was also asked to talk about what is happening in Iran. And as many of you know, I voted against the deal because I did not believe that it would achieve the stated goal of denying Iran the ability to create nuclear weapons. And I had a whole list of reasons. It ruined my summer. All I did was talk to every single constituent who had a concern, read every document that was available and every classified document. And the duration was far too short. It didn't address the development of ballistic missiles or Iran support for terrorism. And it's too easy for Iran to evade inspections, and the penalty for violations is too weak. And once the sanctions are unwound, it is really hard to bring them back. I have never regretted my vote. Quite honestly, I was hoping that I was wrong. I was hoping that I was wrong for the world's sake, for my sake, for everybody's sake. But the events that followed have shown why this was an extremely bad deal for America, and I'd say the world. The sanctions are always most effective when they are broad-based. And one of the big breakthroughs, we can bring the sanctions back, but we can bring back our sanctions. We can't bring back the world sanctions. And the Obama administration and Secretary Clinton worked very hard to get everybody at the table. And I have to note that the Consul General from China is here. We thank her for her presence. And when China joined the table in enforcing the sanctions, that was a huge step for bringing Iran to the table to negotiate. We thank every country that played a role of going to that table. Russia also came to that table. You can't have sanctions if we're the only ones, then they just get around it. So one of the main problems was this, is that we can individually reimpose ours, but we can't bring the rest of the world with us. Now, I want to point out that the U.S. has never dismantled sanctions imposed for Iran's terrorist activities, and U.S. persons are broadly prohibited from engaging in transactions and dealings with Iran or its government. The government of Iran and Iranian financial institutions are still blocked under U.S. law, and that's very important. Our financial markets, many people want to invest in them, they believe in them. They believe where they're safer and more stability in our banking system, and this is a big deal that we have blocked them from that. Even acting unilaterally, the United States can have an impact, although it would be far, far better if we act as a world community. On February 3rd, as many of you know, the U.S. imposed some new sanctions in response to the testing of a medium-range ballistic missile on January 29th. The sanctions were relatively small, affecting 25 individuals and entities that are involved in helping Iran develop ballistic missiles or assisting Iran's support of terrorist groups like Hezbollah. And this is a little more than a warning, but I do want to point out that it was reported by Fox News. I don't always believe what I read in Fox News, but it did say that Iran had removed a missile from a launch pad after these minimum sanctions were put in place by the United States government. So I do not believe that the world has gotten safer because of the Iran deal. And clearly Iran has been emboldened by the loosening of sanctions and the release of $150 billion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Congresswoman, and for the news update. Hi, everyone. My name is Gene Rachmansky. I'm an executive committee member of the JCRC, and it's truly my honor to introduce today Congressman Hakeem Jeffries, who represents the New York 8th District, Southern Brooklyn, and Eastern Brooklyn. It's especially my honor because I went to high school with Congressman Jeffries and was a friend of his brother's, Hassan, and we connected the dots together at the table, so that's always awesome. See, JCRC starts building relationships early, really early. They knew something was going to happen. So, Congressman, tough question. A recent Pew poll has shown that support for Israel amongst the Republican Party is still very strong, but it's actually decreasing amongst the Democratic Party, especially progressives. What do you think we can do as a community to ensure that Israel remains a bipartisan issue in Congress and amongst our elected officials?
Well, thank you, Gene, and good morning, everyone. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. First of all, I'm a progressive Democrat, and I strongly support Israel. I'll start there. Let me thank Michael Miller, who, along with Janice, had the privilege of going to Israel for the first time with them when I was in the New York State Assembly, and it was a tremendous, eye-opening, wonderful experience. I subsequently went back with Bobby Cohen and AIPAC, and that was also tremendous as a member of Congress. I want to thank Eric Goldstein, of course, for his leadership right now, but I also, as a young attorney, had the opportunity to work under Eric at Paul Weiss, Rifkin, Wharton, and Garrison, and to learn the art and science of the law. He prepared me for a whole lot. I'm not sure he prepared me for Donald Trump. But I'm thankful for the training that I received under Eric Goldstein, and it's so great to be here with all of my colleagues in the Congress who are present, and Ari Kagan back from the neighborhood in Brighton Beach and so many others. You know, I've got the honor, and I'll address the question, Gene, in a moment, but I've got the honor of representing a district that is the ninth most African-American in the country and the 16th most Jewish. So my friends in the Orthodox Jewish community say, Hakeem, you got the best of both worlds. And I also represent more Russian-speaking Jewish immigrants from the former Soviet Union than any other member of Congress in the country. I mean, Hakeem Jeffries, who knew? What a great country. So it's an important question, and I think there are two lens through which we can look at the dynamic. One, within Congress, Israel, on the Republican side and the Democratic side, is still a strongly bipartisan issue. And I think that's important, and I know all of us in the New York delegation are committed to keeping it that way. Amongst certain aspects of the Democratic base, broadly defined, on the progressive side, I think it's important to understand that progressives, separate and apart from the issue of Israel, tend to be anti-intervention in their view, anti-conflict, anti-military, however they define that. And so in the context of Israel, constantly immersed in conflict, but not conflict of Israel's provocation, but nonetheless constantly immersed in conflict because of the tough neighborhood that Israel lives in and the need, obviously, to maintain a strong military solely for its survival and to maintain its qualitative military edge, I think there are some progressives who just ideologically have concerns, separate and apart from anything that Israel may be doing. But that said, I think there are two ways for us to continue to try to address what should be a concern, so we can keep Israel strongly bipartisan on the left and on the right, outside of Congress. And the first thing is just to continue to do what JCRC and so many other organizations have been doing, which is to educate folks about the unique dynamic that Israel confronts in trying to be a Jewish democratic state in the face of what was described to me when I first went to Israel, I think so poetically, as a tough neighborhood. I mean, you know, Hamas in Gaza, Hezbollah to the north, issues with Egypt in the south, Iraq in chaos, civil war with Assad and Al-Qaeda and ISIS in Syria, to the east, Iran with continuing nuclear aspirations. You know, I grew up in Crown Heights in the 1980s. I know from tough neighborhoods. That's a tough neighborhood. And obviously, when there are people who are bent on Israel's destruction, there's a robustness, there's a toughness that Israel will naturally have in order to protect its survival and deal with existential threats that it confronts, particularly because we know of the narrow waistband within Israel as it relates to both its infrastructure and its population largely being in the center of the country, in and around Tel Aviv and Jerusalem and the surrounding suburbs. And so I think we need to continue to promote that education process as JCRC and so many others have been doing, and that's going to be important, eye-opening for me every time I've been able to travel to Israel. But I think the second thing that we can do, and this, all of us, I think, can spend more time talking about how progressive a society on the domestic front Israel is today. Because I think that quite naturally is something that would appeal to a lot of progressives within the Democratic Party. And it has the benefit of happening to be true. It's not what we would call alternative facts. Right? So Israel's the only country in the Middle East that prohibits discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation. The only country. It has a tremendously progressive environmental agenda as it relates to conservation. and a whole host of other things related to its use of energy. We know that Israel, unlike the United States of America, has universal health care, is one of the top 10 countries in terms of the health care that is provided to all of its citizens, regardless of race or ethnicity. We know that Israel is a society that has embraced gender equality, and women have been very successful, both in the military context and outside of the military context. And Golda Meir obviously is an example of that. Israel's broken a barrier that we still haven't broken here in the United States of America. And it was done, I think, back in 1969. Israel's a very progressive society, and progressives should embrace and acknowledge that fact. And if we promote that dynamic, I think it will go a long way in terms of dealing with this issue.
Right, and just as a follow-up, vis-a-vis the new Trump administration, and do you have any thoughts how progressive Democrats have to either adapt or change their narrative, or is everything that you just said kind of what we should be running through in terms of strategy?
Well, I think there's still a lot of uncertainty as it relates to how we're going to engage the Trump administration on a wide variety of issues. The one thing that I will say that I think has been troubling to many of us, Elliot Engel, of course, is a leader on these issues, is the top Democrat on the Foreign Affairs Committee, is the footsie that our president continues to play with Vladimir Putin, who's a sworn enemy of the United States of America and is troubling to a lot of us. And Russia is no friend of Israel, and its relationship with Assad and propping up that regime doesn't portend well for Israel when you think about the interrelationships between Iran, Assad, Hezbollah, and Hamas being wholly owned subsidiaries of the Iranian regime and within the same familial context in the Middle East as it relates to Syria and those other entities. And so I think we're gonna have to be supportive when the relationship between Israel and the United States is advanced by the Trump administration, but also be critical when necessary.
Great, thank you. And just one more question that we have for you, off topic, but as a former tax lawyer, maybe that's why they gave me this question. As you know, this year on the agenda may be the elimination of some itemized deduction, including charitable deductions, and much of philanthropic giving is driven by that charitable deduction. Do you have some thoughts on how Congress is going to be dealing with that issue?
Well, you know, tax reform is one of the issues that certainly Speaker Paul Ryan has indicated he wants to put on the agenda and push forward at some point this year, perhaps after they deal with the ACA, and I appreciate the comments made earlier in regard to how important the ACA is for a wide variety of communities. I think on the charitable deduction question, while there does appear to be some momentum on the other side of the aisle amongst the Ways and Means chairman and other folks to perhaps constrain or limit that charitable deduction, I think there's real opportunity in a comprehensive bipartisan way to push back against that, because there are so many organizations, social welfare organizations in each and every congressional district. There are universities in each and every congressional district. There are synagogues, churches, mosques, temples in each and every congressional district. And so the opportunity for a broad-based coalition that crosses race and ethnicity and geography that exists in blue states and red states, I think, is vast. This is not a Republican or Democratic issue. It's an issue of right and wrong. It's an American issue in terms of incentivizing conduct which allows organizations like UJA and JCRC to continue to do your great work. And so I look forward to working to stand behind the law as it currently exists, and also do everything possible to support JCRC and your tremendous work moving forward in Washington, D.C., and certainly back at home in the Brooklyn and Queens district that I love so much. So thank you so much for the Capitol.
Congressman Elliot Engel, representing New York's 16th Congressional District, which, for those of you who don't know, is the Northern Bronx and Southern Westchester, your district. Congressman Engel, we just heard from Carolyn Maloney about the Iranian regime who has continued to test intercontinental ballistic missiles, some of which are capable of carrying nuclear warheads. Given the deal's limitations, which many of us believe, what can the United States do to prevent Iran from testing these missiles and continuing to finance and export terrorism around the world?
Well, first of all, thank you, Susie, and thanks to Zoya and Charlie, and of course, my fellow Bronx boy, Michael Miller, and to all of you. I love these breakfasts, and I'm glad we got them back after a one-year respite. And thank all of you for coming. I want to give a shout-out to my buddy and constituent, Bob Cohen, who was the president of AIPAC for many years. And if I start mentioning anybody, Ravi, or so many people in the audience, you'll be here all day. But one of the things you can see from the people who have spoken, my colleagues and people who will speak, that New York, members of Congress are probably the most pro-Israel members of any state, of any delegation. And, I'm the ranking member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, which simply means that if the Democrats had the majority, I'd be the chairman. Maybe one day that'll come. But the chairman of the committee, a Republican named Ed Royce of Southern California, is also very pro-Israel, and he and I work together very, very closely. And a lot of the legislation that comes out, many bills, are all joint as a result. And we have people from both parties on the bill, and we're very, very strong. My colleagues have mentioned bipartisanship, and that's really important. Israel cannot be allowed to be used as a political football, where one party thinks it's better on Israel than the other party. When I came to Congress back in 1989, we were barely getting the 218 votes we needed for foreign assistance. And you know that Israel is the number one U.S. foreign assistance country, more than $3 billion per year. And now we routinely get into the 300s, or high 300s, there are 435 members of Congress. It's done because people appreciate the work that Israel has done, what Israel stands for, and the work with the United States. And so I feel very strongly that the delegation here, Foreign Affairs Committee, we passed sanctions on Iran back in 2014, which was passed unanimously out of the Foreign Affairs Committee with people from the right and the left and the center. And passed on the floor 400-20, so we can show that there is some strong bipartisan support. Let me mention the Iran deal. I voted against the Iran deal. I thought it was a bad deal. I know that President Obama felt very strongly about it. He called me to the Oval Office for 45 minutes. We had a long discussion about it, and I told him I wasn't going to vote for the bill. Let me tell you briefly why. Number one, during the course of the years leading up to the negotiations, Iran came to the negotiations because Iran was broke. They had no money. Their currency was worthless. They couldn't do any kind of programs to help a restless population. And so they had no money. Despite the fact that they had no money, they still were able to be the number one state sponsor of terrorism when they had no money. So when this deal goes through, as it has, and Iran gets billions and billions of dollars, Imagine how much more money they'd have for terrorism. That's one reason I couldn't support it at all. Secondly, if you look at the bill and you read it, you notice that it doesn't really stop Iran from having a nuclear weapon. It postpones it for 15 years. That's good, but to me, what happens in 15 years? Iran will be a nuclear threshold state, and there'll be nothing preventing her from having nuclear weapons. So that really wasn't good enough for me. Now the question goes on, though, that now that the bill is in place, and Iran has gotten its billions, its millions of billions of dollars, what do you do? Iran has reaped the benefit of this deal, and now it's time for us to reap the benefit of the deal. So I don't believe that canceling the deal now, even though I was opposed to it, is the right thing to do, because this way Iran has stolen money and can laugh all the way to the bank, and yet the restrictions that we have imposed on Iran have not yet been carried out. So I want to make sure that Iran lives up to every obligation it's supposed to live up to under this deal. And so I think it's very, very important, again, that we speak with one voice, and we do that. Second thing I want to raise wasn't necessarily in the question, but I think it's very, very important. And that is, when you look around the Middle East, and I talk to all the countries, including Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, all the things in my capacity as ranking member, you find one thing, that their worldview is very, very similar to the Israeli worldview. That for the first time in ever, perhaps, there is it's congruent, there's a confluence, where when you speak to the Saudi ambassador, you almost think you're speaking to the Israeli ambassador. Because they understand, finally, that Israel is not the threat in the Middle East to them or to anybody. The main threat, and I believe it, is Iran. Iran is the one stroking all these things, talking about destroying Israel. 4 days after the Iran deal was signed, the Ayatollah led a march and rally in Tehran, chanting death to America, death to Israel. Now you just signed a agreement, and 4 days later you're talking about death to the country that you signed it from. So I don't believe them, and I believe that they are the ones who are the most mischievous in the Middle East. And so there's lots of opportunity for Israel and the Sunni Arab states. There's a lot going on behind the scenes some we know about, some we don't know about. But I think, hopefully, we'll portend a new era where people will look at the Middle East and see the way it is. Now, what was the second question?
Given that you support moving the embassy from Tel Aviv to the capital of Israel, Jerusalem, how do you do that without causing instability in the region?
Look, the state of Israel was founded in 1948, and there are people always telling Israel what it can't do, what it shouldn't do, what it can't do. I believe in moving the embassy to Jerusalem because Jerusalem is the capital of Israel. And I don't accept the fact that people say, well, you know, if you move the embassy, it's going to cause problems, it's going to cause this, it's going to cause tough on the Arab street. Too bad. There are places, no one is suggesting that the embassy be moved to East Jerusalem. The part of Jerusalem that it would be moved to wouldn't be far from the Knesset, and is a part that has always been Israel since the founding of 1948 of the state, and will be Israel if and when there's a peace agreement with the Palestinians. And I hope there is a peace agreement with the Palestinians. But the fact of the matter is, every other country in the world declares where its capital is, except for Israel. And I'm tired of it, and I don't think it's fair to say to Israel, well, you know, if you move the embassy, the Arab street is going to be upset, and there's going to be riots and whatever. I mean, if that were the case, you wouldn't have had an Israel in 1948. So I think we need to move on. And we need to also show, by the way, that there's no daylight between the U.S. and Israel. Because when we show that there's daylight, that's when the Palestinians dig in their heels. And everyone here knows the story. There were twice did we think we came very close to an agreement. Twice. Once was under Ehud Barak, and once was under Ehud Olmert. One was in 2001, one was in 2008. There was almost an agreement, it was 98% done. Israel accepted it, and both times the Palestinian leaders turned it down. So So when people talk about Israel and saying, you know, settlements are the main obstacle to peace, settlements aren't the main obstacle to peace. The main obstacle to peace is that 70 years, just about 70 years or 69 years, after the founding of the Jewish state, the Arabs still don't recognize the fact that the Jewish people are entitled to a state of their own. And to me, that's why there's a problem. If they say that they will accept the Jewish state, I tell you there'd be peace in a couple of months. But if you don't accept Israel's right to exist as a Jewish state, and you don't accept nationhood for the Jewish people, and then you blame them, the Jewish people, for the fact that there's no peace, to me that's a little convoluted. Because again, both times, Ehud Barak, Ehud Olmert, accepted all these things, the division of Jerusalem, all kinds of things that we thought they'd never accept. They did it, and the Arabs, the Palestinians, said no. So when people are pointing and they're throwing words around, we ought to be very careful. And finally, and then I'll sit down, I want to mention the BDS movement, even though it wasn't a question, because I think it's very, very important that we understand the threat of the BDS movement and the anti-Semitism in the BDS movement. And it doesn't matter that it doesn't mean that you can't criticize Israel, the Israeli government. Heaven knows we criticize our own government here in the United States. But the fact of the matter is, BDS, as far as I'm concerned, is anti-Semitism, pure and simple. And we need to do everything we can to eradicate it. Thanks very much, and thanks for coming to the press.
Thank you, Congressman Engel. Before we introduce the next member of Congress, just a few additional acknowledgments, and just as well as a heads up, if you take a look at the Statement of Community Concerns, the booklet, which is in front of you on your tables, and look on page 3, you will see that the Jewish Community Relations Council supports the moving of the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, so we identify with what Congressman Engel has just said. Again, a few quick acknowledgments and sincere acknowledgments to the president of the Turkish Heritage Organization, Ali Sinar, the president of the Azerbaijan Society of America, Tomris Azeri, the president of 100 Black Men, Michael Garner, from the New York State Assembly, Honorable Felix Ortiz, from the New York City Council, two members who are here, Elizabeth Crowley and David Greenfield. A dear friend who just came back on a mission to Israel. We took 11 African-American pastors from Brooklyn, and one of them escaped from their church this morning to come to join us here, and that's Reverend Alfred Cockfield, the Reverend of God's Battalion of Prayer and the Battalion Christian Academy. Rev, great to see you. I must acknowledge someone who's been associated with the JCRC for as long as I have, and that is Howard Rubenstein, the chairman of Rubenstein Associates, who joins us here today with his wife Amy, who's on our board. Okay.
Michael. Good morning. I'm Josh Moskowitz, and I'm pleased to introduce somebody who I had the pleasure of meeting 10 years ago when she visited the AIPAC office during her first run for Congress, representing the 9th Congressional District, representing Central Brooklyn, the Honorable Yvette Clark. And the first question we have, Congresswoman, is the world has become increasingly threatened by so-called lone wolf terrorist attacks. And despite the appearance of them operating on their own, investigations have shown that many of these attackers have been in direct contact with ISIS and using encrypted messaging to allow them to communicate. And many of these attacks have been on American soil. Wondering how Congress plans to deal with this issue, balancing national security interests with online communications companies to try to crack down on these threats.
Thank you so much, Josh, for that introduction and the question. And to our dais leadership, to all of the rabbis in the room, to all of my community friends and supporters, to my colleagues who are all here present, a pleasant good morning to you all, and certainly to those who went through Tubat Shvat this weekend, a pleasant one. It's certainly a challenging issue that we have confronted as a member of the Energy and Commerce Committee, I was given the responsibility of serving on the House's encryption working group. And this working group was put together in a bipartisan manner out of concern for the challenges that we are facing with communication in end-to-end encryption. We did a deep dive into this issue, and it's very complex. When you think about the fact that there's the ability to communicate and execute terrorist activity without being able to actually detect it or intercept it or have the ability to recognize when those types of threats are appearing in online communications, it really leaves our nation at a disadvantage. But we try to look at what the challenges are for industry, what the challenges are in terms of American privacy, and what the challenges are in relation to the threat. It became increasingly difficult when you think about industry and the desire to remain sort of strong in terms of proprietary and intellectual properties to sort of crack that nut. So we then began to shift towards the expertise and developing the expertise around how we decode encryption. And part of the emphasis that our working group came out with is really a need to develop this expertise far beyond where we are today. To ask a company to develop a key, if you will, opens us up to even bigger threats. For someone to be able to access that key in any form of fashion, not only plunges those companies into sort of a tenuous situation, but it also opens us up as a society to extreme vulnerability. From what we have been able to gather thus far, the answer lies in our ability to really develop the expertise far beyond where we are today in being able to essentially hack ourselves in order to keep up with and address the need for us to be able to break through the encryption codes. That's not very comforting because we're not where we need to be right now, but we recognize that this is a sort of a quagmire issue, and we have to unravel it very carefully when you think about privacy concerns, when you think about intellectual property, when you think about the proprietary nature of our communication development, and when you think about national security for the United States of America. So that's pretty much where we are right now. I'm sure this is to be continued in terms of our conversation, but I just wanted to make sure that everyone was aware of the dynamics that we're addressing.
Thank you for the thoughtful answer. One more question is, Israel comes under a consistent condemnation at the United Nations, as we all know. Last year, singled out for 20 times anti-Israel resolutions, whereas there were only four other countries' resolutions going after other countries last year. So what do you believe is the role of the United States in protecting allies of the UN like Israel?
Thank you again for that question. We've always maintained a posture as the United States of America as one who would stand in the gap when other nations would turn hostile, would create a dynamic by which the ability to really conduct a process of dialogue that is bilateral is compromised. You may be aware that just in this Congress, we have passed H.R. 7, which is a resolution that really looked at the move that was made to abstain from vetoing the U.N. resolution that many of us saw as being extremely one-sided, condemning Israel, but not really lifting up the dynamics with the Palestinian people and their their transgressions, if you will. And so I believe that it is important that we maintain that posture in the UN, that we are there to make sure that there's not a pylon, if you will, but that cooler heads prevail, that we maintain a safe space for bilateral conversations to take place, for the negotiations to be between the two parties, and that the intervention and the obstruction and the bullying, if you will, that can take place in a body like the UN is something that we are able to guard against, push back upon, and again, create that safe space for the conversation to take place bilaterally between Israel and the Palestinian Authority. So I believe that you will find that most of us maintain that posture. Most of us in the New York delegation and in the United States House of Representatives, and we want to strengthen that going forward as we look at the days ahead. So to each and every one, again, thank you for inviting me to participate. As always, it's an honor and a privilege to be here. I represent, I think, probably one of the largest concentration of Jewish Americans in the United States of America. I know that Hakeem was boasting this morning, but I think I have the bragging rights. And Tom says he has the fourth largest. Fourth never gets the prize. In any event, we support Tom and his fourth largest population as well. And to each and everyone, once again, thank you for having me.
So it used to be that if you couldn't show up someplace or you were late, you'd get a note from your mother or your doctor. And now, these days, you get one of these things. So we were just texted a little while ago by Senator Schumer and told that he has been asked to be on one of the morning TV shows, and he sent his regrets that he couldn't make it this morning. I know that I've known Chuck for over 30 years, and I know how much he looks forward to this particular breakfast every morning. Every Sunday that we hold it, he regrets not being able to make it, but he also asked that we extend his good wishes, and he said he will try to make it next year.
Hi, my name is Harrison Denman. I'm pleased to introduce Congressman Tom Suozzi, representing New York's 3rd District in Northern Nassau County. Congressman Suozzi, you traveled with JCRC New York to Israel on a mission in your previous role as Nassau County Executive. How did that experience inform your current role and service on the Foreign Affairs and Armed Services Committee?
Good morning. Bruchim Abayim. I want to thank you so much for inviting me here. I represent not just the Nassau, I also have Suffolk County and a little bit of Queens, so I'm now officially a New York City Pol. Very excited about that. Many of you have heard me talk about this before, so I apologize for those of you that have heard about my trip to Israel with Michael. Back in 2002, I was the Nassau County Executive. We went in the fall, right after the massacre in Hebron during the Second Intifada. And it was a very, very important experience. And I want to tell you how important these trips are for elected officials, because I learned so much during that trip. And I don't want to, you know, this was a life-changing experience for me. And now that I'm serving on Foreign Affairs and Armed Services, I think this is going to continue to always influence. I know this will always continue to influence me. But let me just tell you, I went with Adriano Espaillat, who will be up here, I'm sure, in a few minutes on the trip as well. But it was a very, very important experience for me. We went to the King David Hotel. It was completely empty because no tourists were there at the time because there were so many bombings going on, so many bus bombings were going on. And we visited Yad Vashem, which, of course, was incredibly moving. Someone spoke earlier, Carolyn Maloney spoke earlier about the Holocaust. You know, my high school We actually had required reading was Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl, one of the most influential books in my youth. So that was very important. We met with Renan Gisan, who is the spokesperson for Ariel Sharon at the time. We went to the Hadassah Hospital. I'm meeting with Hadassah in my district soon, I just found out. But we went to the Hadassah Hospital. I can't tell you how moved I was to be in that hospital. And when they took us around, they showed us how state-of-the-art it was. But we saw the skin bank, where there was literally skin that they would preserve for people who were burnt during the bus bombings. We went to meet with the American ambassador to Israel at the time. We went to a university and saw how they made the desert bloom, and we're talking about software technology then, which we know is so important in the world today. And back then in 2002, it was just starting at the time. And it was a very, very, I met with Shimon Peres of blessed memory, who explained to me, as a county executive of Nassau County, about the two-state solution. And I still believe so strongly in the two-state solution, and I know how impossible that seems right now, but I still strongly believe in that, and will always fight to try and make that a reality. But it was this moving, political, governmental, educational trip. And then we walked over to the Western Wall to say a prayer. And the Catholic kid who went to St. Patrick's Grade School, Chaminade All Boys Catholic School, Boston College, and Fordham Law School, both Jesuit institutions. I've got more guilt than anybody in this room. You've got me beat, you don't. But all of a sudden I realized this is where Jesus walked. And this became an incredibly spiritual experience for me. And then we went over to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And I couldn't believe that I was here. I started thinking about the whole meaning of my life. And I decided that I had to go to church. I had to go to Mass at the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, except it wasn't on our calendar. Wherever we went, we were with armed guards. There was chicken wire on the buses wherever we went. We couldn't go anywhere without someone carrying a machine gun escorting us around because it was such a dangerous time. So I said, I have to go to Mass. I can't be in Jerusalem and not go to Mass while I'm here. So I snuck out the next morning with another assembly person at 7 o'clock in the morning without our armed guards, and we went to church at the to Mass at the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And I remember thinking to myself, oh, I'm so proud of myself. I'm such a good Catholic boy. I'm going to tell my mother when I got home, that I went to church like this. And it was so courageous of me that I would sneak out of the hotel without my armed guards, without people, monitoring my activity. I'm so proud of myself, I'm so courageous. And then we walk outside the church, and there's all the little girls getting on the bus to go to school that morning. And it hit me like a thunderbolt. The idea that these were the people that are courageous, the people that live in Israel, the people that for, at that time, 60 years, have been, everybody's trying to kill them. Everybody's trying to destroy their very existence. And despite that, they maintain their democracy. Despite that, they maintain the rule of law. Despite that, they participate in the international community. Despite that, they made the desert bloom. Despite all of this pressure, they've continued to live up to the values that we hold so important in the United States of America. So I decided at that very time that no matter what I would ever do in public life, that I would always be an ardent and strong supporter of the State of Israel and everything that it does. So I don't want the people in this room that support the JCRC to ever underestimate the importance of these, and I've learned so much since then and read so much since then. I don't want you to underestimate the importance of the educational process that you do with elected officials. And I just want to comment briefly on something that Hakeem answered before about this gap between Democrats and Republicans, and how in the old days it was seen as the Democrats were the strongest supporters of the State of Israel, and we see that lessening all the time. And I think that Hakeem gave a very intelligent, thoughtful response to that. I'm very proud of all my colleagues and their responses, quite frankly. Elliot Engel is just wonderful. I serve under him on the Foreign Affairs. You couldn't ask for a better friend. But we Democrats from New York, the elected officials, need to do a better job of communicating with our fellow Democrats throughout the country about the importance of this relationship. And I want you to know that I will partner in that effort in any way that I can. And I think that Hakeem gave a great roadmap as a vehicle by which to do that, and I'll participate in that effort any way that I can. So thank you very much. Am I supposed to answer another question?
One more question,
okay.
Congressman Swazi, during your campaign, you discussed your support for promoting partnerships between the Israeli tech sector and our own private sector and research institutions to enhance not just military applications, but clean energy, bioscience, and medical advancements. Now that you've been elected, how do you plan to create these partnerships?
You know, there's so many things you talk about during your campaign, and then all of a sudden you get there, and it's like unbelievable. I mean, every week the whole world is going crazy under Trump. It's like so much that we have to focus on. And I want you to know I'm on a thing called the Problem Solvers Caucus. I'm the vice chairman, which is a big deal as a freshman, of the Problem Solvers. One guy knows about it. Thank you. My cousin is here. But the Problem Solvers Caucus is 20 Democrats and 20 Republicans that are meeting with each other on a regular basis, supported by an outside group called No Labels, to figure out how can we work together in a bipartisan fashion to actually get something done. So, you know, I was asked not to go to the inauguration, for example, by a lot of my constituents. I received a lot of letters. You know, I went to the inauguration, not about Tom Suozzi and Donald Trump, it's about the President of the United States of America and the United States Congress. That doesn't mean that I will be critical of things that I disagree with that President Trump has done, and I'm going to be watching things very carefully. I'm very concerned about this whole Putin connection, and we have to really watch this very carefully, and the whole thing about his financial interests we have to watch very carefully. But anyway, so regarding this issue, my district is home to a lot of research institutions. Steve Israel, who's my predecessor, did a great job of trying to promote cybersecurity. I think it was actually, I read about it in the or someone was speaking about it, about all the work on cybersecurity that's going on in Israel right now, all the software work that we all know about, the work with biotechnology. I'm home to Cold Spring Harbor Laboratories and to the Feinstein Institute as part of North Carolina, as part of Northwell. So I think that the more that we can do to figure out how to build partnerships, this is a great idea for economic growth, but it's also a great idea for building relationships, strengthening the relationship between the United States of America and Israel. And I think that I'm going to be going to Israel in August. I will start planting some of the seeds before I go to try and foster a collaboration between the research institutions, the defense contractors, quite frankly, in my district. And with friends in Israel, and I hope that will result in not only economic growth in my district, it will help the state of Israel, but most importantly, it will build this partnership. Thank you very much, everybody. You've heard so many speeches already.
Thank you, Congressman.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Esther Fuchs. I'm a member of the JCRC board, and I'd like you to please join me in welcoming the first Dominican American representative in Congress, Adriano Espaillat, representing the 13th district in Northern Manhattan in the Southern Bronx. I have a question for you. You can join me, and I'll ask my question very quickly. During your entire career, you've been a supporter of immigrants' rights, and you've done it before you came to Congress. Now we have a balancing act to do, a need to balance between security and our historic tradition of welcoming immigrants. Could you please speak to us about how you see policy on this issue?
Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Before I answer the question, I may not be the 4th district or the 5th district, but I got Yeshiva and I got Dr. Roof. I think Dr. Roof is worth a couple of million Jewish constituencies. Okay, so, Tom, don't feel bad that you're in fourth place. But look, we're all looking to see how we balance this very critical issue and challenge, right? And that is, how do we continue to be a nation of immigrants? How do we continue to foster the vision of our great nation, and particularly of the city of New York and the state of New York? I represent the district that has the George Washington Bridge. I see that as the gateway to New York City, right? This is sort of like a an entrance to a neighborhood, Washington Heights, which has been the cradle of the immigrant experience in New York City. And so you have people from all over the world settle there and left their mark there in a positive way. And that neighborhood is very strong because of its diversity. So how do we balance the vision that we should continue to be a nation of immigrants and at the same time be a secure nation? And I think that we can accomplish that. I think that we must strengthen the vetting that goes on when folks come here. I think that there's room for improvement there to ensure that all the I's are dotted and all the T's are crossed to ensure that no one comes to this nation with ill intent. You know, it's not just about those nations, it's about the region. And just recently I signed on to a letter with Congressman Engel, who, by the way, was very instrumental in getting both Tom Suozzi and I to be members of the Foreign Affairs Committee. As freshmen, we met each other and we asked each other, what committees do you want? And we both said, Foreign Affairs and Transportation. And we acknowledged right there and then that we were diametrically opposed and we were going to crash because we wanted the same committee. But Engels was able to ensure that he pushed very hard for both of us to be a member of that committee. And I signed on to this letter, which condemns and asks for sanction against corrupt official and military officials in Venezuela that are promoting the sale of passports to members of Hezbollah. And so this is not just coming from certain regions of the world, this is right in our backyard. And how do we strengthen the method and the process through which folks are able to enter the country is an important one, while not making it illegal to be an immigrant. And so this is a major challenge. I think that we can balance. I don't agree with the wall. I don't think the wall is the answer. I think that that's not the answer. There are other methods that we could use that are probably more effective in ensuring that we continue with our legacy of immigration while having strength in our security here in the nation. And so we must do a better job of vetting folks that come into the country. We must do a better job at having a relationship with the embassies of those countries to ensure that they're also vetted over there. I was at the airport, for example, JFK, where the ban was implemented. And the two families that I met there were both military families. One was a young man, a member of the U.S. military, whose mother was coming to the United States for the first time with her green card. And she was detained and questioned. And you know, it broke my heart because the young man was so committed to our nation that he didn't want to speak to the media. He didn't want to make any public statements. He called his superiors in the army to ensure that he proceeded to act in accordance to regs without violating any of the regs of the armed forces. And that shows you the commitment that he had to our nation. Yet his mother, who was over 60 years old, was detained and questioned for hours with a green card. And so that's not security, right? I don't think that's security. That's not what we're talking about. I don't think that should be the welcoming statement of our nation to any mother of a military person. The second person was a young man who's also a member of the armed forces whose aunt was coming to the country. And she was also detained and questioned at JFK. And both of them, by the way, were allowed to come in after many hours of questioning. And so this is not the country that we should stand for. We believe in public safety, we believe in national security, but we are also a nation of immigrants. And I'm sure that we have the tools and we have the knowledge and technology to ensure that we do better at vetting who comes here and who can be dangerous or who could be our friend. Thank you so much for the question.
I have one more question for you, and it has to do with job creation. We all know that unemployment and job training are always on the agenda now, but particularly now we have a focus on those folks who lost their job during the period of deindustrialization as factories are closing. So what can we do for this segment of the American working population who hasn't really been sufficiently retrained for the high-tech jobs, but we need to figure out a way to get them employed again in decent-paying jobs?
Of course, and that's a great question. Both my grandparents, who came to the United States before I was born, were factory workers. My grandmother worked as a seamstress in the garment industry, and my grandfather worked for the Ray-Ban sunglasses out in Queens. We were probably the only kids in the neighborhood that had those flip-down baseball glasses. Everybody hated us because we had those. My brother and I had the privilege of being able to catch fly balls under the sun. But those factory jobs left a long time ago, and the economy has since changed dramatically from a service economy to a knowledge-based and technology economy. And so things are moving very rapidly, and some folks are unfortunately are being left behind. I like to think that one of the major opportunities that we will be facing, we will be having here in New York City, is the fact that we have several mega projects, most of which are transportation related. For example, you have the construction of the Tappan Zee Bridge just north of New York. You have LaGuardia Airport. You also have the Gateway Project, which will be a tunnel from Jersey to Midtown on 34th Street, and the new city that's being built in the rail yards. You also have the Penn Station project and the extension of the Second Avenue subway, not only to Harlem, 125th Street, but further south. These mega projects will inject billions of dollars into our local economy for the next 10 to 20 years. And then the Second Avenue subway has been around for 100 years. We finally got it done this year, but the extension, hopefully, and both Caroline Maloney and I are fighting to keep it on that list of infrastructure projects that are being floated around by the Trump administration. We think that this is a great opportunity to engage folks like that in the workforce. And I think the major challenge is preparedness and how do we train those folks to be job ready once those projects get up and running. And I think that particularly with young people, that this is presents a great opportunity for employment locally in New York City, in my district and the districts around it as well. Again, this will inject billions of dollars into the economy. It will be a major job producer. How do we partner with the unions, with academia, with the universities to ensure that our young people are prepared and ready to apply for these very competitive jobs that will be available and good paying jobs that will be available through these projects. And in the process, I think that they will be trained in areas that will make them marketable in the future for other projects that may come our way. So these are five mega projects that I think will transform the city of New York. The Second Avenue subway will transform East Harlem dramatically. If you have access to the Second Avenue and 106th Street in East Harlem or 116th Street or 125th Street, that would transform that neighborhood dramatically. Businesses will spur, jobs will be created. So these are important projects. The Gateway Tunnel will provide an additional, that's Chuck Schumer's baby, that will provide an additional route of transportation from an already congested route of New York, New Jersey. The Tappan Zee Bridge, and I don't need to talk to you about LaGuardia Airport, right? We all know what the Vice President said about LaGuardia Airport. So we need these projects. New York City is a wear and tear city. It's like your brake pads, right, in your car. Once it starts squeaking, you know it's time to change them. And so New York City has to have state-of-the-art airports. How could we be behind Midwest cities that have these spectacular airports. We have perhaps one of the biggest tourist industry in the world, and yet folks are coming from all over the world and they're landing in LaGuardia and JFK, second-rate airports. That's what New York City should be about. By the way, there are other airports that are also going to be developed, including JFK, certain parts of JFK. So these are major job opportunities. The second part of the question, I think, is small business. How do we help small businesses create jobs? Because for a long time, and they continue to be the major employer in the United States and in New York State, and yet small businesses have been left behind, perhaps at the expense of helping the big box stores, which are very prominent now in our neighborhood. So the big box stores come in and they hire young people, and they, very often our small businesses are pushed out. But I think in the future, particularly next year, in 2018, we will have a $15 an hour minimum wage. That's an important accomplishment. And I speak to working families in my district all the time, and they tell me, I'm having a hard time making ends meet. I'm bringing home, they tell me, how much rent do you pay? They tell me, well, I pay $1,200 a month. I said, that's not a lot of rent. I'm sorry to tell you that. You probably won't be able to get that kind of rent anywhere else in the city. How much money do you make? Well, I'm making $400 a week. I said, you have a pocketbook problem, right? You have an income problem. But now that person that was making $7.25 2 years ago, minimum wage, will now be making $15 an hour next year, more than doubling her income. She may be able now to cover the expenses of rent and the cost of living in a city that continues to be more and more expensive to live in. And so this is a real boost to families, but more importantly, that person is not going to go on a Caribbean vacation anywhere. She will probably go to the local grocery store and buy items of first need, and she will inject energy, oxygen, into small businesses. We need that because they continue to be the biggest employers. They're overly regulated. They're overly taxed. I think they're, you know, we got to protect small businesses if we want to create more jobs. And those are the two areas that I think are very important, the mega projects and how do we help small businesses to move forward. Thank you so much for that second question.
Okay, everybody. There are times over the years where we had this breakfast that it actually began to move into lunch, and people were afraid that it would be moving into dinner. So this year, due to two things, weather and under the weather, as you'll hear in a second, the number of members of Congress who were able to join us today have joined us. Regrettably, Sean Patrick Maloney, due to weather, was unable to come, and Kathleen Rice and Nydia Velazquez were under the weather, and they were not able to come. And we heard about Chuck Schumer because of TV and the role, as he indicated in that text, as Charlie said, the new position that he has as the minority leader in the United States Senate. So what I'd like to do is to make a few more acknowledgments, several thank yous, and then you can have lunch at home. and there's enough food out there, you might want to have lunch here too. Anyway, I want to acknowledge, I don't know if she's still in the room, Patty Lubin, the senior advisor to Senator Gillibrand, Ilana Schwartz from Congressman Joe Crowley, who couldn't make it, Ellie Peltz from Jerry Nadler, who couldn't make it, Rabbi Daniel Pollack from Congresswoman Grace Meng, who couldn't make it, Minna Elias accompanied Carol Maloney, who was able to make it, and since I'm mentioning political names, I'll mention my colleague Jason Coppell, the Northeast Political Director of AIPAC, who's also in the room. And most importantly, I want to thank Zoya Raines for chairing this morning's breakfast. Yay! Charles Temmel, the president of JCRC, first year go around. Terrific job. UJA Federation for serving as our host and major benefactor to UJA. A round of applause. And most especially to Capital One and Steve Tulip, who's been here the entire time. Thank you very much. We need, today is the day we need more tulips. I'm sure you get that a lot. Okay. And this event would not happen without the incomparable staff of the JCRC. This event led by Marcy Fishman, who's sitting over there. The statement of community concerns that you have on your table was drafted by Stephanie Fite and Noam Gilbert and David Pollack. Let's give them a round of applause. Jennifer Glick, who did such an amazing job of serving as support staff, along with my executive assistant, David Kerner, as well as Rebecca Abrams, Miriam Edelman, Marsha Eisenberg, Susan Green, Kathy Gersha, Mitchell Harris, Bob Kaplan, Karen Lander, Mindy Perlmutter, Marley Peerless, Isaac Rothbart, Grant Silverstein, Hannah Wienerman, and Dori Zofan. Let's all give them a round of applause. If I missed anybody's name, my staff will tell me. I don't think I did. I read off the list. And on behalf of all of us, we thank you for joining us. As Charlie indicated, our gala is on March the 29th. If you can participate, we hope you do. I hope to see you then. Otherwise, we'll see you at many other JCRC events over the course of the year. Shalom to all.